My name is Harsh.
And I'm Shreyas, and it's been a really long time.
Absolutely. Welcome back to Good Band Filmy. Thank you for joining us. We are doing
the one and only
Joker.
Oh my god.
I can't wait. I'm bursting with excitement for this movie.
Yep.
As you guys already know, there's a lot of Oscar buzz around it. There's a lot of praise that being heaped on to Jacquin Phoenix for his character and his portrayal.
Yeah.
And there's, I just have so much to say. I can barely contain myself right now.
Exactly. So let's just get to the spoiler talk. Okay, maybe not. But before we get into our good, bad and filmy bits, how is this different? Like, why is it a big deal and why is this... Like, we've seen so many Jokers, right?
Absolutely. We've seen around, I think, 5 or 6 portrayals of Joker
right now.
And this is the first movie where you've got an origin for him.
For
Even
sure.
Even in the comics, Joker's always been a very ambiguous character. You have no idea where he's coming in from. You have no idea about his, you know, origins, what kind of a person he was.
Right.
There have been different hints to different things, but it's always been very ambiguous.
Correct.
It's always been very vague.
Yeah.
And even he says, like, in The Killing Joke, I prefer my origin to be an MCQ.
Yes.
Which, yeah.
Multiple choice. Like,
absolutely.
That's messed up.
And that's Joker, absolutely.
Right. So this is totally origin story. This is how he reaches to that persona of Joker. So he might start out as your everyday Gotham citizen, and then, obviously shit hits the fan. But the weird part is that, like, the entire journey of watching this movie, there is zero, like, other characters as part of the DC universe.
Absolutely.
It is just Joker and him being a part of the city of Gotham.
There's no Batman, there's no rogues gallery, there are no side villains, there's no
Harley Quinn.
Subplot, there's no Harley Quinn, absolutely. This is Joker end to end. This is Joaquin Phoenix carrying this entire movie end to end.
Oh my god.
And I just can't wait to talk about the goods, man.
Right.
Let's get into the goods.
Yeah. Starting off, it is a little more than 2 hours. It seems slightly longer than it is. And yeah, we saw a really late show last night, so I was yawning through it a lot. However, don't let that fool you. It is so intense. There's so much of build-up. And that build-up is almost justified towards the end because there's so much happening in the end. So kudos to the director. Like, this guy, I mean, the fact that he's done Hangover and Due Date, I'm like, why would, like, Warner Bros. Do this?
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's done War Dogs as well, which is a pretty good movie.
It's a fun movie, yeah.
Right, but this just takes the cake, and I guess this comes from a lot of inspiration from Kings of Comedy and Taxi Driver.
Absolutely, yeah.
And obviously Robert De Niro's casting is not, like, coincidence.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, this movie, it's so different. It's freaking grimy, and oh my god, like, it's just, like he keeps on saying, like, he watches movies multiple times. I think I might have to watch it again because there's just so much to take in. Despite that it's slow, you still think it needs a second viewing. So that's kudos to just the way it's shot and everything else.
Absolutely. I couldn't have put any better. Firstly, I think I've already said this. I think we've said this before.
Yeah.
Todd Phillips, before this movie came out, was the biggest, you know, question mark in my mind. Is he going to be able to put it off? Because Hangover was the only thing that he's done, the trilogy there.
Right.
The first two were good, the third one was shit.
Yeah.
War Dogs is a fun movie, right? But again, it's not like an Oscar contender.
Yeah,
or Oscar,
it's another fun
and
type
the
movie.
The fact that here Todd Phillips is able to get a performance like this out of Phoenix, who himself is a fantastic actor, taking no credit away from him.
Yeah.
And you've got an amazing supporting cast. You've got Robert De Niro as
Daisy Beats.
And just everybody on the set, he's done a bang up job.
I think
the movie shot, the way the different, the lighting, everything, A to Z, the cinematography, the way shots are directed, everything, A to Z, everything is spot on. Todd Phillips is like, you know, he's there with this game.
For sure.
This movie, 100%.
For sure.
He knew exactly what he wanted with this movie.
Yes.
The movie is, obviously, like you already said, it's about this character and his journey.
Right.
And this is, I would compare it to Breaking Bad, man. Like,
I've
never
say so.
Seen something. Breaking Bad had 5 seasons to do it. This movie had 1, you know, 2-hour journey to do it.
Right.
And that character progression, the way it happens, is so believable. But that by the end of it, when I just look at him, I don't see that, you know, I think of the same people anymore.
Right.
But it's been so gradual progression that you just buy into it.
Totally.
It's
totally.
Not a leap.
Absolutely. Yeah, and just like you were saying, like, cinematography, but I mean the colors, the way certain frames are shot, beautiful. However, the soundtrack, like, there's not a lot going on, but the way it sort of leads into building up with the build up was like, oh my god, something's gonna happen, something's gonna happen. And there were so many times when, like, we just looked at each other and we're like, oh my god, what's going on? And this is crazy, and we're getting goosebumps and whatnot. So yeah, it's been a weirdly fun ride.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
And it takes some time to sort of understand what exactly just happened.
And while we're talking about it, why don't we just talk about Walk and see next time?
Yeah.
This guy, he has acted his heart out.
Totally.
You're seeing he's gone to a really dark place with the character. There are times in this movie where I can't believe the kind of shit that he's doing.
Yes.
It is just too real. Like, someone with mental illness, the way they portrayed mental illness,
right,
someone who's not been given the right help.
Yeah.
All of that, the way they've portrayed it.
Right.
It just, it's gut-wrenching.
Correct.
Punches you. It just moves you, man.
Correct. And yeah, and just the way they show it with respect to not just family and friends, but like the whole society, the city as
absolutely
a whole sort of, not betraying him, but he feels left out. He feels like he's not noticed, he's not heard. And obviously, you know, when things have to really like go all the way to the end, and then, you know, he sort of comes into his own. And like you said, yeah, those two sort of picturizations of beginning and end of his character, Arthur Fleck.
Absolutely.
Holy hell. Like, there is so much going on. His mannerisms, everything else, that, you know, the way he carries himself, he's kind of not malnourished, but he seems weak-ish.
Yeah.
And even like, he's living it up and he has his moments, but he still seems downtrodden.
Yeah.
So to do so many things in one go and then progress it, yeah, man, this guy, Joaquin, running, whatever you want to do, Phoenix, my man, that was insane.
And to the movie's credit, how many times have we had Gotham City in a movie? I'm
yes.
pretty sure. We've had like, I think, 6 or 7 Batman movies right now.
Absolutely.
We've had a lot of TV series. We have Titans on right now.
Right.
We've seen Gotham a billion times.
Yes.
But this movie doesn't. This city is sentient.
Absolutely.
This movie. This is the first time I've seen this city, Gotham City, that I'm talking about.
Right, like a.
Just, yeah, that real.
Living,
that
breathing entity.
Exactly. It has its own personality.
For
it has its own, you know, individualistic characteristics.
Yeah.
And you can just see the city in itself.
Yeah.
Gotham City is done really, really well. Like, this is the first time I've been super happy with Gotham City, the way they portrayed it.
Totally, I get it. I think this is supposedly in the 70s, 80s, around that time. And yeah, just like, even the tone of the color, the sunrises, sunsets, that kind of stuff, it just sort of takes you there, like you're almost there and you're feeling it, you know, everything that's going on.
The war between the rich and the poor, the entire thing, I'm like, this is comic book Gotham.
Absolutely.
Like, this is what Batman need to, this is exactly what accounts for Batman being there.
Right.
This is why he had to be there, because this city is so messed up.
Exactly. So on that freaking point, I want to talk about why Batman is missing. So can we get into the bads? Talking about Batman, in the very first few scenes, you see Gotham, you see the subway train, the way it's panned out, panned in, individual shots, I was like, where's Batman? Like, he has to be here somewhere hiding. Like, we need, like, this movie, this scene, this setting needs Batman. And I think that's an ode to how well it's shot, how well Joaquin Phoenix plays that character, because that's exactly like, you sort of, like, it gives you another element to realize why Joker is Batman's nemesis. And despite how smart Batman is, despite how righteous he is, he'll never freaking understand how, like, what kind of character and what motivations a character like Joker has.
Absolutely.
And this movie, like, explores that. So, technically not a bad, but in some weird-ass universe, can you please get Batman? Like, Robert Pattinson, if you're watching this, get in, bro.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. You do feel Batman's not there, and you know, this is, again, Batman's world. It's his established city.
Right.
It's, his father's obviously a big part of the movie and everything.
Yes.
And there are times where you're like, dude, this is exactly why Batman is there. Like,
right.
No other person in his right mind or in a right city would ever be Batman.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
So I can completely understand that. And another gripe that I think people would probably have, apart from just the Batman, you know, relations and the entire world building it.
Yeah.
It might be a little slow for some people.
I get that. I mean,
I think it's totally justified.
100%.
This is a slow burn. This is a character piece.
Yes,
and you need for a character piece to be good, it needs to breathe. It needs to just, you know, be able to do whatever it wants
to
the character.
Right.
And that progression is always going to be slow. But at the end, when you're at the end of the journey,
major reward.
It's just, it's, yeah, absolutely. It's just super fulfilling.
Yeah.
and you're just messed up by the end of it. You're like, shit, what have I just seen? It, this movie like literally affected me. I was deep in thought by the end of it, and I just couldn't get this movie off my mind.
Yeah, there's almost too much happening in the end. It's just almost like orgasm after orgasm after orgasm, but you're like guilty of having those orgasms.
Yeah,
you're
the
like,
last 20 minutes is, oh.
But yeah, continuing on bads, I get where he's coming from, and I'm not a big fan of slow movies. Yes, if they're gripping enough, I will stay there for the journey. But I think we're so used to superhero movies having so much of like activity and action and stuff
absolutely,
like that.
Absolutely.
Whereas obviously this being a character in that universe, there's nothing superhero about it. It's absolutely, like you said, pure character building, pure from, you know, they establish who he is, what he is, his immediate sort of surroundings, and then how those surroundings change around him and how those changes change him.
Right.
And yeah, if you're up for the journey, you won't freaking regret it, because like you said, in the end, that reward is just insane. You're just jizzing all over.
Absolutely. I think we already have something to talk about. Let's just get into the...
Filmy? Yes,
yeah,
please.
Let's just talk more.
Considering the fact that how hyped up this movie is, it's also sort of caught in some very random crosshairs. One of them being that because this is so real in terms of how a messed up society, a messed up city, messed up surroundings can affect like the general public.
And someone who's mentally ill.
Ill, right. Yeah. So, you know, they end up taking very, you know, extreme measures. There's some, you know, versions of violence and stuff. And because it's shown so well, poor Jacquin Phoenix has been getting questions in interviews that do you think people will be inspired to do the stuff that you've done, like in terms of, you know, doing and like taking over anarchy and shit. So I think that's a bit unfair. It's just so random, and because this movie's got so much of hype with the Oscar buzz and stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I think that's just stupid. But at the same time, it is kind of chilling how real and how sort of down to earth this character is. And like literally, when he's, you know, sitting in the bus, when he's walking around his daily commute, and there's this certain...
Even his colleagues, everyone around him, where he's working, his work as well, right?
Absolutely. And there's this part where there's a staircase, and we've seen that in the video, in the trailers as well. And because that's close by, you see him going up and down a lot.
Regularly, yeah.
Yeah, just the way that shot, the way they show the end of the staircase, that horizon, it is just insane. So it is really stupid and unfair to give it its credit that it is so real, but don't say that people are actually doing that
absolutely,
stuff.
Absolutely, man. Like, I think, again, so obviously there is a lot of controversy that is surrounding this movie. There's a lot of Oscar buzz, there's a lot of controversy, there's just a massive, massive buzz around this movie right now.
Right, right.
And to this movie's credit, it does kind of like make you feel for him.
Yes.
You do feel bad for him, but in no way do you kind of think he's doing the right thing.
Absolutely.
You're never saying, oh man, these guys deserve this.
Correct.
And no way is this movie kind of like promoting gun violence or promoting violence in any manner.
Absolutely.
You feel bad for this guy's character and his descent into madness and the route that he takes, but in no way is it supposed to be fulfilling.
Yes.
You're always left feeling like, oh shit, like this is the worst humanity can be.
Absolutely.
This is the point of the movie, and I think if it's taken like that, I think this could be like a, you know, talking thing against gun violence, right?
Totally.
If you look at it from that perspective, this could be the other end of it.
Correct. I mean, I agree. And like his character shackled by so many things around him, it's just that he's unshackled by the end of it.
Right.
And it's a certain sense of beauty to see him sort of live it up.
Absolutely.
And that's sort of categorized by a lot that's happening in the city as well. So it's almost like, which is what he said, like the city is living and breathing, and it's almost Joker personified in Gotham City. And the way it just unravels right in the end is just, it's insane. It's too much to take in. And
absolutely.
If I want to see the movie again and skip the slow parts, I think I'll just go like an hour late and like catch it in the interval and just watch the second half.
You guys don't do that. That's the second time he's talking about it. You have to see it from the start.
Right. But yeah, man, do yourself a favor if you haven't seen it already. Please, please freaking watch it. There is so much to take in this movie. It's insane.
I am definitely going to go check this movie out twice or thrice again for sure. This movie deserves a second viewing, even just to, you know, understand the character better, because there's just so much that's going on with the character, even though it's a slow movie, like you've already said.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm definitely gonna get this. Let's just get into the rating, man.
Oh, I forgot about the ratings. Oh damn. Oh shit. Oh, after I genuinely think.
Two days later.
considering the fact that there's so much of buzz, I'm sure Todd Phillips, the movie, Jacquin Phoenix are all going to be nominated at least. Let's
absolutely, they deserve it, man.
Yeah, yet to be seen if they actually win or not.
Yeah.
And the fact that when this movie was screened like a month ago during these film festivals, standing ovations.
8 minutes standing ovation.
Yeah,
man.
Applause and whatnot. Yeah. I thought that was a bit much. Funnily enough, we had some applause during our screening as well. And yeah, on IMDb it was 9.3 a month ago. It was 9.5 as of yesterday when we saw it. Today is 9.4. I think it'll definitely survive as a 9+.
Yeah.
And yeah, simply for that reason, I think everyone's on board. Maybe a bit more than I thought it was, because I don't really look forward to DC stuff, at least on the big screen. But yeah, this deserves its spot, and it's a definite blockbuster for me.
Oh yeah, I couldn't have put it any better. This movie, for a comic book movie, whether it's a comic book movie or not, as a character piece,
in
both aspects, it's fantastic. Yes. It's phenomenal. It's an amazing character piece. It is obviously really, really heavily inspired by Taxi Driver and King of Comedy.
Yeah.
You can see all the, you know, inspirations there in the movie. But I think Todd Phillips did a bang up job with this.
Very surprisingly.
Almost very surprisingly emulated Scorsese, I would say. He's done it that well.
Yeah.
And I would definitely give this a blockbuster.
Big blockbuster.
Absolutely.
Nice.
So that wraps up our review for Joker. Do yourselves a favor, watch this movie as soon as possible. You don't want anything getting spoiled for you.
Yep.
And in the comments below, do let us know who's your favorite Joker. Let's put you guys there. Ledger, Joaquin Phoenix.
Not fair.
Or if you guys are into Jack Nicholson.
Ew. Jared Leto somewhere?
Oh my god. Let us know who your favorite Joker is in the comments below after you've seen the movie.
Yes.
And yeah, thank you so much for all the love and support.
See you.
Yeah.
Tomorrow. Very soon.
Spoiler talk coming your way.
Yeah.